From 1941 to 1945, during the Second World War, the United States and the Soviet Union became allies in the battle against a common enemy, Nazi Germany. Although relations between the two countries had been strained before the war, the U.S.-Soviet alliance was marked by a great deal of cooperation and was essential in ensuring the defeat of Adolf Hitler's Third Reich. Hitler was crushed from both sides, with the Soviet army pressing in from the east and the United States and Britain closing in on the west, until the Allies met in Berlin in 1945 for the final defeat of the Nazis. Now, as early as 1945, there were already signs of serious strain in the relationship between the United States and the Soviet Union, and it was unclear what would happen to the alliance once the war was over. The United States, under the President Franklin Roosevelt and then Harry S. Truman, and the USSR, under the leadership of Joseph Stalin, clashed over post-war policy in Europe and elsewhere. There was a particular conflict of interest over the fate of Germany, which proved to be irreconcilable, leading to the eventual division of the country into East and West Germany. By 1947, the outlines of a divided Europe had appeared, with a Soviet-dominated zone and a US-led zone separated by military power, what Winston Churchill called the Iron Curtain. The conflict between the United States and the Soviet Union was intensified by the invention and rapid proliferation of the atomic bomb, which ushered in a new age in which military conflict could potentially lead to nuclear Armageddon. This resulted in a stalemate, a bipolar confrontation in which these two superpowers, the United States and the Soviet Union, rather than war with each other directly, sought to expand their influence through economic and military warfare throughout the entire rest of the globe. This confrontation, known as the Cold War, dominated global politics for the next 40 plus years. Of course, there is a lot missing from this very terse account that I just gave you. Remember, you are detectives of history. So you have, as historical investigators, questions. Lots of questions. Here are a few. What did the opponents in the Cold War want? Why did the United States and the Soviet Union mistrust each other? Why did the Cold War spread to the entire world? Who started it? I like that last question. Who started it? We always take this to be the most important question about any fight that anyone gets into. And Cold War historians are no exception. Now, most Americans in the 1950s and 1960s had a pretty simple answer to this question of who started it. It was Stalin. Or, to be more specific, the blame for the Cold War lied with the Soviet Union because it had a post-war policy of aggressive expansion in Europe and abroad. Although the United States was allied with the USSR during the war, when the war ended, Stalin and the Soviet leadership showed their true colors by attempting to dominate a weakened Europe for the purposes of spreading their totalitarian communist ideology across the world. They would say that Stalin was no different than Hitler. Like Hitler, he was a dangerous, megalomaniac, maniacal dictator with pretensions to global power. And so the United States and other free nations, or nations in the free world, had no choice but to draw the line and stand up to communist aggression wherever it appeared. The Cold War was, for the United States, a necessary defensive confrontation. And that sounds at least plausible. However, by the late 1950s, some academics, professors, and students started telling a different story. They claimed that the true story of the origins of the Cold War was actually the opposite. It wasn't communism that was to blame for the Cold War, but rather American capitalism. They argued that the United States was not simply reacting to Soviet aggression after the war ended, but in fact following through with plans that its leaders had developed while the war was still on. In particular, American policymakers were determined that whatever global economic and political order emerged, in the aftermath of the war, it would be one that benefited and supported the interests, especially the economic interests of the United States. It would be a US-led world order that would ensure national security and economic prosperity through mechanisms like the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the United Nations. Such a system would quite naturally be unacceptable to the communist regime of the Soviet Union. But that didn't matter. American leaders knew that the balance of power between the two countries was skewed completely in U American favor. The United States had the bomb, had most of the world's gold, and had a booming industrial economy. The Soviet Union, on the other hand, had was completely devastated by 5 years of constant war. So the American agenda for the global order, backed by the power of the United States government, was the real root of the Cold War. So there you have two very different accounts of the same exact historical event. One answers the question of who started the Cold War this way. The Cold War was the fault of the Soviet Union because its policy of aggressive expansion and communist world domination forced the United States to take global defensive measures. And the other answers it this way. The roots of the Cold War lie in American plans for the post-war global order because they called for a capitalist world economy that was incompatible with communism and driven by the United States' military and economic power. So, which answer is right? As you can see, this is all a matter of debate. These are historical arguments, and arguments lie at the heart of what it means to do history. When historians make arguments, they are entering into conversations, sometimes very intense and contentious debates, not only about what happened in the past, but how it happened, the way it did, and why it is significant. In fact, these two particularly extreme arguments you see here were part of the fighting of the Cold War itself, and they didn't end when the Berlin Wall came down in 1989. So when you think about developing a historical argument, take the job literally. You're entering into a debate, and you're there to defend your position. Doing good history always begins by asking questions. We ask questions about the past and look for the answers in historical sources, both primary and secondary, by analyzing them. That is the necessary and creative beginning of the process of doing history. And as you do this, you move from being an investigator, gathering facts and information, to a scholar. When you begin formulating answers to your questions by developing arguments. In academic terms, an argument that you develop in your essay is your thesis. Now, your thesis is a statement that reflects what you have concluded about the topic of your paper based on critical analysis and interpretation of the sources that you've examined. Since the thesis, or argument, is the central idea that drives a history essay or a historian's book, it is important to understand exactly what a thesis is. So imagine you've been given the following history essay assignment. Was Reconstruction policy after the Civil War primarily a success or a failure? Why not? Okay, so you got that you have this assignment. Now, as you begin to develop your thesis or your argument in response to this prompt, keep in mind the following points about what a thesis is not. Now, these may seem really obvious to you, but there are really common pitfalls in when developing historical arguments. So a thesis is not a description of your topic. A thesis statement needs to do more than just announce the subject of your purpose for writing the paper. So the following: the purpose of this paper is to evaluate whether Reconstruction policy was a success or a failure. Is not a thesis. That's simply a statement of the topic or assignment. A thesis is also not a question. Historical research starts. It's the first business of a historian is to ask questions, but a thesis comes from the attempt to answer the question. So the following is not a thesis. Why did the policies of Reconstruction end in the failure to protect civil rights? Not a thesis. A thesis is not a statement of fact. Now, this is one of the most common traps. A thesis is an argument, not a simple, uncontestable statement. And this is a little freaky because a lot of times you might be a little bit nervous about advancing an interpretation when you don't think it's an ironclad fact. But a statement of thesis is not a statement of fact. It's an argument. So this is not a thesis in response to this question. The period of Reconstruction involved a series of federal policies designed to deal with the aftermath of the Civil War. Not a thesis. That's simply a statement of fact. On the other hand, a thesis is not simply your opinion. So it's not a statement of fact, and it's not simply your opinion. This is another common misunderstanding that is that because a thesis is your argument and interpretation, that it's just a matter of opinion. But the following is not a thesis. The Reconstruction period is my least favorite period of U.S. history. Not a thesis, just an opinion. Okay, so you're probably annoyed now with all this stuff about what a thesis is not, what it isn't, and are wondering exactly what it is. Well, okay then. A thesis answers a question. It's not a question, it's the answer to a question. In the previous example, it would answer the question about whether Reconstruction was a success or failure and why. Often the most compelling arguments address questions how or why. A thesis is your interpretation. It's not your opinion. Your interpretation of the sources and data that you've analyzed. The key distinction between a thesis and an opinion, or an interpretation and an opinion, is that a thesis is supported by evidence. That is what your research into the sources is all about, the gathering of evidence to persuade your reader that the way you've interpreted the facts makes sense and is valid. You're making a case and defending it, not simply relating a list of facts, and not simply just saying what you think your opinion is. That's why a thesis must be debatable. A thesis is a conclusion with which a thoughtful reader might disagree. If your thesis is not debatable and contestable, it is probably just a simple statement of fact and not an argument. It's your job in the body of your paper to provide all the evidence necessary to convince the reader of your claim. And then finally, a thesis is clear and specific. The broader and more general your argument, the vaguer and less compelling it will be. The more specific your thesis is, the tighter, more direct, and more persuasive your paper will be. So that's a lot to throw at you right there, and I know that. Why don't we take a look at a few examples in order to, you know, be more specific about what we're talking about here. Let's go back to that question. Was Reconstruction policy after the Civil War primarily a success or a failure? Why not? And we'll take a look at three different possible responses to this and see if they constitute a thesis based on the criteria that we just looked at a second ago. So here's the first one. The Civil War was followed by a contentious period of political, economic, and social rebuilding in the South known as Reconstruction. You could pause the video for a second and take a look at that and see what you think. Okay, so this fails on most counts as a thesis. It is only moderately specific, and it doesn't answer the question, at least not the one posed. So the question was Reconstruction policy a failure or not? This just tells you about Reconstruction. But the real issue here is that this is not a debatable statement. This is a statement of fact. It's not an argument. You can't really argue against this. This is just a definition of Reconstruction. So it's not a thesis. Here's another one. The process of Reconstruction in the South after the Civil War ended in failure. Okay, this is a little bit better than the first one in terms of our list of criteria to be a thesis. It answers the question, sort of. It's also debatable. Another person could disagree with this statement and pose another interpretation. So, very simply, someone else could say the process of Reconstruction in the South after the Civil War was a success. So it's a debatable statement. This is, right here, technically, a thesis. The problem is, it's a really weak thesis. It's not specific at all, but very, very vague. So, although it technically constitutes an argument, it's not a very strong argument. Here's a third example. Despite some important political reforms, Reconstruction was ultimately a failure because the retreat of federal enforcement of civil rights left African Americans in a condition equivalent to slavery. Now, this one has a lot of muscle to it. It satisfies all the criteria of a thesis. It answers the question and the direct question that was posed. It provides an interpretation of the topic that somebody could debate. For one thing, another historian or another writer could argue that Reconstruction was not a failure. But even more, you could debate whether the failures outweighed the successes. You could debate the assertion that African Americans were left in a condition equal to slavery. The strength of the overall paper would come from the evidence marshaled to support this particular argument. Now also, note the use of the word because in this thesis. Including the word because in your thesis is a good thing. Because it forces you to answer the question why, which is the Socratic question, the deepest, most intriguing question that you can ask about the past.